This tutorial is going to take you through some PowerPoint do's and don'ts. Hopefully it will help you make better presentations in the future. The first step is to know your design, and the main thing that you have to think about here is to customize. That means everything from your colors to your fonts to your backgrounds, shapes, and effects. And the important thing that we need to remember here is that customization can be done from within PowerPoint. Obviously, you can choose a template and or a style, and you can even customize that style a little bit. But you really should think about customizing to your story and to your brand. Even if you use one of those templates to start with, you should go into the master slide template and edit it to make it brand congruent and story congruent. The second thing is to keep your bullet points short and memorable. You don't have to talk in bullets, obviously, but you should think about making your PowerPoints in terms of sound bites. That doesn't mean that you should speak in sound bites, but you can always explain the points more fully, but the things on the PowerPoint, the copy on the PowerPoint should be short and really memorable. In other words, people should be able to take something very quickly away from the PowerPoint, and you should be able to expand on that verbally. The third point is you have to ask yourself whether words are even necessary for many of the points in your project. You might just have a deck with a bunch of images in them, or maybe some slides will have copy and some slides will have images. If you can inject some images to remove some of the copy from your PowerPoint and just stand in for it, let's say you're talking about freedom of speech and you have a picture of the Supreme Court, or you have a picture of somebody with their mouth taped shut or something like that. Those are ways to create a kind of visual affect with your audience, but at the same time, really kind of liven things up a little bit. Don't use this too much, obviously, and you really, again, need to think about this as being brand congruent and story congruent and tone congruent. You don't want to have an image, let's say, of a lolcat or something like that in a PowerPoint for the American Cancer Society or something, unless it, of course, is a really well-chosen piece. The fourth point you need to think about is that layout is really key. The way that you frame things, you don't want to necessarily have a logo, for instance, in the upper left-hand corner really strongly, and then copy down in the lower right or something like that. You really need to think about layout and make sure that the important things are in on the top, and then you move down from there. Try to follow the standards of reading, unless you happen to be a very talented graphic designer and you want to play with that a little bit. But remember, in most cases, you're not looking for edgy with your PowerPoint. You're looking to just make a point and make a presentation. You'll see in this presentation, I've got the Rollins logo at the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. But it's not too big, and it is mostly transparent. It's about 60% transparent, which doesn't actually take too much away from the visuals. And of course, this is a very simple PowerPoint. The fifth point here is you have to really think about infographics. Are they your friend or are they your foe? An infographic is any visual representation of information, and this could be a basic graph, or it could be a flow chart or a process flow or something like that. But in many cases, infographics are abused horribly. It's difficult to tell what they are, and it's difficult to understand what the person means by them. Step two is to know your transitions, and you can see here there are transitions from slide to slide, a blur in from one to the other. It's a very simple ease-in transition, and they look really good. But the important thing is that consistency keeps us sane. If you had me do a different transition for every slide, it would drive you nuts, and it would distract you. The last thing you want someone to do is to remember your PowerPoint, usually in a bad way, rather than remember what you said during the PowerPoint, right? You are using the PowerPoint as a tool, as a backup to illustrate or give structure to your speech or to your presentation, but the PowerPoint is not the most important thing. You are. The second issue is that changes can make us wake up. Now, let's say you've got a PowerPoint deck of 20 slides, and you can separate those slides into maybe four pieces each, five sets of four, or four sets of five, or whatever. At those transition between sets, you might actually want to have a different transition. So maybe you go from a fade in to a slide or to something like that. But you want to be careful about that, because louder isn't better. Now, you don't want to have one of those, let's say, rotating 3D cube transitions, or the ones where it changes the, folds up the screen and turns it into a little origami crane that flies away. Those just look tacky, and they are very, very rarely consistent with your brand. The fourth point here is to always remember your story. The transition should fit the story. If you're doing something where you're actually going through, let's say, the slides of a place or a vacation, let's say, or an archaeological dig, maybe actually having it look like a slideshow would be fine. But in most cases, that's not going to be the case. You really want to have the transitions fit the story. Step three is similar, and that's know your animations. You can see here I've got animations for each point. When each bullet comes in, it fades in evenly, right? Each of them fade in point by point. And of course, that's consistent with the transitions. The first point you always have to remember is, should you animate or should you not animate? Is it important to animate? And I think that it often gives a really nice flow to the presentation, but often it just kind of distracts, especially if you choose one of the weirder animations. Simple animations are usually better, and the simpler, I think, the better, the more elegant, the better. It's very difficult to lose with elegance. It is very easy to lose with just about anything else. The second point is you really have to not be annoying. You don't want to have flying in animations. You don't want to have twirls or anything like that. So you should think about how to make an animation that looks really good. And often this might be an animated arrow or an animated graphic or something rather than just some random animation for your copy. The third is use animations to keep the audience's attention, but you don't want to go nuts with them, not just to not be annoying, but if you don't keep their attention yourself and their attention all goes to the PowerPoint, they will forget you, and they really won't pay attention to what you're actually saying, but what the PowerPoint is doing. The fourth point is to think about your multi-level animations and the flow. I've got my animations done here on click, so every time I click the mouse or click my next button, the next bullet comes in. But you might want to have this automatically come in, meaning with previous or after previous. So it shows some division to your points, but it doesn't make you click each time. And many speakers get very distracted by having to click each time. Step four is to know your audience. And this might be the most important piece. You have to know who you're talking to. And there are some key questions here. Do you have rapport with your audience? In other words, do they know you? Do they like you? Are they excited to listen to you? Are they expecting you to be funny? That really defines how you present. Are you presenting something? Are you proposing something? Are you justifying something? Are you just playing around? What are you doing? In each case, your slide deck is going to change drastically along with that that type of presentation. The third is that demographics matter. So if you're talking to young kids, you might want to have things that are a little bit more playful, sharper with color or whatever. There are animations that speed in and just keep their attention, things that are playful, that have humor. But if you're talking to an audience at, let's say, a retirement community, or if you're talking to the C-suite in a boardroom, you really want to be very careful about making any of those kinds of things. Making somebody laugh might, in many cases, not be a good thing. So remember that audiences think differently. So you have to customize even the same presentation for different audiences. You don't want to think that you can give the same PowerPoint deck or the same style of presentation in general to two different audiences. And that's a very important thing for aesthetics, the visuals and the audio, for the narrative, the way in which you structure the story, and then the style and the voice in which you speak. So the last piece here is to emphasize again, stay brand congruent. You really have to use your brand's colors and fonts. And this really depends. You know, in some presentations, I use Rollins colors and fonts, kind of like this one. In others, I deviate from that because this obviously isn't constructed by Rollins. It's constructed by me. So I might want to just demonstrate a different kind of flow, or I might want to keep consistent with a different presentation or something like that. The second point is to use brand-appropriate tone for your animations and transitions. Like I spoke about before, if you are going to use animations and transitions, you have to be very careful about the brand, because if you deviate too strongly from the brand, it can reflect not only badly on your presentation, but on the brand itself, and that can get you fired really quick. The third is to not just tell your story, but to tell the larger brand's story. So in other words, if you're making a presentation for Disney, certainly you're making a presentation that tells your story, but you also are reflecting on the Disney brand. So you have to think about how you can tell that brand's story and really make things that are congruent with the interests of that brand. And I would say it's the same thing for just about anything. If you're working for Habitat for Humanity or if you're working for, I don't know, the federal government or any kind of institution, even for a small business, even for even if it's your own business, if it's your own business, you're telling your personal story, but you're also telling your business's story, and that's different. So really the important thing to remember from all of this is to try to make a very strong, tight presentation that all connects from one to the other. Good luck. I look forward to seeing your work.